It's part of a class of technologies called language models, where the goal is essentially to try to produce text in response to some type of human query or some kind of question. And really the goal of this text is to be coherent and meaningful and responsive to whatever users are attempting to ask for. The idea of language models is quite old, but the kind of technology that's really enabled them to work well enough to really be useful for a lot of applications is something quite new. And ChatGPT is one of the first such language models that's really captured the public's imagination and now has a lot of users and can be used for lots of different applications.
Perhaps one analogy is, like, think of it as a calculator, but for writing. We still learn how to do addition, multiplication, etc. by hand, even if we have calculators. So it's the same thing. We still will learn how to write good articles, even though we have this tool. But it is true that we should encourage our students to harness the power of the tool while understanding its limitations.
So one of the really exciting things about language models is they, in some sense, know a lot of things. The way they're produced, going back to the way they work, is that they've been exposed to a huge amount of data, mostly coming from the internet. So it's similar to whether you've shown someone all of Wikipedia and you've asked them to memorize all of these articles. Being exposed to all this data basically means that they can answer a ton of different questions. Not always perfectly. In fact, they'll often be somewhat inaccurate. But they can produce what looks like a very coherent response on almost any topic that you can ask it. And this means that if you're trying to get questions answered in whatever area or field you're in, it's natural to ask ChatGPT to produce an answer for you, or even to produce potential other places to look for and learn more about it. There's a couple of different things that you can do for example, everyday tasks. Like if you need to write a letter that has a certain tone or that has to have some requirements met. So for example, you'd like to have an application for something done. Then ChatGPT is very wonderful technology because it can actually essentially do that for you to a certain extent. So for example, if you're trying to write a recommendation letter or you're writing an application for something like a fellowship, then it can produce at least an outline of what you would like to express in that letter. It can also do things like directly try to answer questions in paragraphs. If you'd like to learn more about a particular topic, coming from a certain point of view, it can produce something like that. And it's actually quite usable for many of the different academic areas that we have here at Wisconsin.
One application is to polish up something that you already have. And this is very relevant for many of our foreign-speaking students who may not be at the level of proficiency that is required for professional writing. And one useful way to use GPT is to write a draft, but ask it to paraphrase for you in a tone that's professional. And that has been quite useful for many of my students too. More broadly speaking, it doesn't just apply to second language speakers. Anybody can benefit from this level of, essentially proofreading.
I think people should be very careful about these tools because there's no way to know how truly reliable they are in settings outside some very limited kind of test set that the creators of the tool have developed. And it could also lead to some potential inequities, really. So for example, it's been shown that a lot of the proposed detection tools really have a lot of false positives on kind of English as a second language speakers compared to native speakers. And that could lead to things like discrimination if people are accused of potentially cheating when in fact they're not doing so. So I would just caution folks who are looking for this kind of product that could really help them to be careful about what they use and not to take any one of these tools to be kind of the authoritative answer for what was generated and what was not.
I have exactly the same message. When you use AI tools, large language models, generative AIs, be conscious of the potential misinformation that's being produced. This is many times due to the nature of such models. So as of now, do not think that these models can think. They cannot. They're just predicting what word is appropriate or seems appropriate or has been used often historically. So it doesn't really generate new facts. It's not a logical reasoning system yet. It's not good at that. So when you use generative AI, be careful, because sometimes it just puts wrong things out. And it will create wrong sources. It will cite even the wrong sources to justify that. You have to do your own research.